Warning, the following program has been rated T for truth.
You can't handle the truth.
Oh, we think you can. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report with your host, truth warrior and myth buster, Kathleen Wells. The place where we distinguish fact from fiction, where data is used to drive points home, and where Kathleen takes the position that Democrats and black politicians have destroyed black America. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report. Now, your host, Kathleen Wells.
Hi. Well, welcome, truth warriors and myth busters. I'm excited to be here. It's nice to get out now because why? There isn't much traffic driving to the studio. In fact, there's hardly any traffic. In fact, it reminds me of driving on the weekends 30 or 40 years ago, 30, 35, 40 years ago, right? I did see an accident on the way into the studio because why? It's raining and I think it's unusual. There's not much traffic. There are not a lot of cars on the street, and yet there's a car accident. Well, it's because of the rain, possibly. But I heard the other day, I think it was yesterday, that there was also an accident on the highway, and yet there wasn't a lot of traffic, and it wasn't raining. So people are driving recklessly with less traffic, maybe? I don't know. So I didn't want to discuss, well, last week I discussed the coronavirus a little bit. I also had Dr. Robert Woodson on, and we discussed his 1776 project. Be sure to check that out. But I touched on the coronavirus, and I don't like to be reactionary. I like to see how things played out. And I thought by now maybe the coronavirus would have played out by now, would have plateaued or something. It wouldn't be such a big deal. I'm looking forward to the Durham report coming out. That's what I'm looking forward to. And I don't like to just react. You know, you listen to the media and the news and you are constantly in a state of crisis. There's a constant emergency. I mean, we've gone from impeachment to now coronavirus, right? Well, let's see. Gavin Newsom, our governor of California, said that more than 56 Californians will be infected with the virus. That got folks really, really, really concerned. On the brink of paranoia, hyped up and anxious, no doubt. Also, Governor Cuomo said that New York, 40 to 80% of the people in New York State will be infected. That's the kind of numbers that the governors of the highest populated the states which have the highest population are the highest percentage of people infected, New York and California. Yeah, us here in California, not for nothing with our open borders policy. But I don't think open borders has anything to do necessarily with us having so many people infected. I think the fact that we have a lot of people, a lot of first-generation Americans in California, in Los Angeles, San Francisco, Los Angeles, who travel to China, wouldn't you say? Anyway, I'm delighted to have as my guest Dr. Wen Chen. Dr. Wen Chen is a biologist. She has her graduate degree, or no, rather her doctoral degree in biology, and she studies gene sequence. She got her doctorate degree, from Caltech, and she's from China. This is exciting because she's going to inform us about, she's going to give us like the 411 as to what's really going on with this coronavirus. So, Dr. Wen Chen, thank you for joining us on the Naked Truth Report.
Glad to be here, Kathleen.
So what? Exciting. Well, I know you have a doctorate degree from Caltech, in biology, and that you study, and also you curate, that's what you curate, genomics. What does that mean exactly?
So, yeah, you know, biology is a very big field. We all have some basic understanding about the virus, immunology, and my background is genetics, and I have been working as a scientific curator for 20 years. For a global project. So basically what I do is like I read all the cutting edge publications and I extract the most important information out. And I write the softwares, I make database so that all researchers around the world can use the information. Because, you know, there are so many publications published, like there's not one person in this lifetime can read everything by himself or herself. So I'm one of the brains doing that, reading the papers and summarizing information and presenting the most valuable information to the researchers. And I'm also a public speaker on human rights in China because I was born and raised in China. That's what I do, like when I'm not working, okay? I also summarize information from news from my contacts in China and all over the place, and I give talks and I give many presentations about human rights in China, about Chinese society.
Mm-hmm. And I've read that you say scientists who study gene sequence are suggesting that possibly the virus coming out of Wuhan province is man-made. Do you want to speak on that? Elaborate.
Yeah, so, okay, let's go back to the beginning of the story, because soon after the news came out about the Wuhan virus, right, the Chinese government's first reaction said that they claim that the virus came from this Wuhan, Huanan seafood market in Wuhan. They claim that it all became because people ate animals from there. It was because of contact with animals, and then it spread to humans. But soon after that, on January 24th, I think, the Lancet magazine, one of the world's leading medical journals, published a research article. It was published by Chinese medical doctors. So they studied the first 41 cases of the Wuhan virus. They found 13 of the very early cases, including the very first patient who came to hospital with this COVID-19, had never been to the Huanan seafood market. So the first patient they got actually was a 70-year-old man. He had a stroke, he had Alzheimer's disease, so he had never left home for months. And obviously, he was not patient zero. And so one-third of the first cases had never been to the Huanan seafood market. It clearly indicate like, probably someone got the virus and took it to the seafood market and then created an outbreak, you know, in the seafood market.
Mm-hmm.
And then people started wonder, okay, it was interesting because just 20 miles away from this seafood market is China's biggest biosafety lab, level 4 biosafety lab in Wuhan Institute of Virology. And they have been studying SARS and all these coronaviruses, like highly, highly contagious. And also... just consistent with this hypothesis, like because one of the major labs there, led by researcher Shi Zhenli, they have been doing this, we call it a gain-of-function study of SARS virus. So basically, they genetically engineer new viruses or make recombinant viruses to make them more contagious. So they published a paper on Nature, so that's the world's best journal on scientific research, said they made a highly, they made the mutations in bat and SARS, like coronaviruses, and they made it more contagious. They make it able to infect like mouse, and then they're trying to work on monkey to make it infect a monkey. And that was really, some scientists felt very upset about it, because once this kind of virus escaped from China, escape from the lab, it would be a disaster, right? You can imagine that. And so I think it's reasonable to have this kind of suspicions, like because the lab has been doing this kind of research and they're able to make something like a Wuhan coronavirus. Mm. And it's reasonable to have this, hypothesis, like whether they're related. And of course, Shi Zhenli denied that. Like she said, "Oh, I made other viruses, but I didn't make this one." But actually, as a matter of fact, the Wuhan coronavirus is 96% identical to a kind of coronavirus discovered in Yunnan. That's about 1,000 miles away from Wuhan. It's also a bat virus. But there's no way, you know, bats can fly all the way 1,000 miles to Wuhan and infect people.
Mm-hmm.
And as a matter of fact, Huanan seafood market, they never sold bat, you know. So it's kind of interesting. It's really like a very strange, like the Chinese government insists like this virus came from bat and came from Huanan seafood market. And it's also suspicious, like right after they discovered the virus sequence, it was on December 31st, actually December 30th, they discovered that this virus is like, you know, very similar to a Yunnan bat virus, and it happened to be like a Shenzhen's lab has been studying this Yunnan's virus. So the coronavirus in Wuhan discovered is 96% identical to one of the viruses that Shenzhen has studied in her lab, and this virus only existed in her lab and in Yunnan province, about 1,000 miles away. So of course, people has, you know, it's reasonable to ask, you know, maybe something escaped from her lab. Whether or not it was genetically engineered, it doesn't matter. Maybe she didn't make it. Maybe something like that, you know, escaped her lab. And as a matter of fact, China has a long history of poor management on biosafety. In 2004, the SARS virus escaped from a lab in Beijing at least twice and caused some deaths. So, but of course, Xi Jinping would never admit that, and it looks like the Chinese government, no matter what, refused to admit that. And what they did was that right after the Chinese government found out the sequence of the Wuhan virus, they immediately closed the Huanan seafood market and cleaned up it, and now it's already wiped out. You know, every building was thrown down. So there's no way you can go back to find out what happened in that seafood market. And China's refused to investigate on the patient zero. You know, I told at the beginning of the story, like the first patient they got was a 70-year-old man who had never left home for months, right? So it should be very easy for them to find out who contacted him, who brought the virus to him. You know, with the surveillance ability of China, they have facial recognition, they have so much surveillance, you can track down every individual. It should have been very easy for the Chinese government to do so, but China never did that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think they will.
So well, how did you find out this information?
Oh, the first it was reported by BBC Chinese report, but the Lancet research article, you can find it online. Anyone can access it. You just search Lancet coronavirus. It was published on January 24th. That was a publicly available article. And the patient zero story, the first one, patient they found went to Wuhan Jingyitan Hospital. So BBC did an interview with one of the authors of that article, and she told about the first patient they got, and BBC Chinese.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not here. Most folks in America, and it's not being reported in the media, that this is a man. It's very highly likely that this is a man-made virus. We're not hearing that in the media here in the United States.
Yeah. I think like it's a very political issue.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I'm pretty sure that the Chinese government, they don't want people to feel like it was genetically engineered,
mm-hmm.
and they don't want people to feel that it escaped from the lab. And also, right after the conspiracy theory came out, right, it was very interesting because the Chinese government immediately passed a regulation on biosafety. It was like just 2 days after the conspiracy theory of the Wuhan coronavirus came from the lab. Xi Jinping passed the biosafety regulation on February 17th. And I was very surprised when it was passed because the lab, the biosafety level 4 lab, was established in 2015. So they have been operating without any biosafety regulation for 5 years. And at the same time, 27 world-leading public health professionals published a statement on Science magazine and claimed that Shenzhen did not make this virus. It was natural. It was now escaped from the lab. And that's where all the mainstream media picked up news. They say, oh, all these top health, public health professionals said the virus was not man-made, was not a genetic engineer, was not leaked from the lab. But how could you say, how can an outsider say it was not an accident? Okay, nobody can say it was not an accident because they don't work there. And if you look at the names of these 27 scientists, half of them were either Shenzhen's collaborators or they have been receiving research funding from the Chinese government. So definitely they have some kind of incentive to publish such a statement to favor the Chinese government.
Now let's talk about the time frame. When was this first patient one, the older man with Alzheimer, who had not gone to the market, had not left his house? When was he first diagnosed with coronavirus?
He actually went to the Wuhan Jingyintang Hospital, I think around 1 week after he had symptoms. And I don't know whether he's still alive, but because that was all according to the interview. So like definitely before December 8th or 10th.
Mm-hmm. Before December 8th or 10th. And,
yeah.
And you know, Iran and China are saying that, are suggested or maybe stated that American soldiers brought the virus to China. Have you heard that?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, I'm not surprised, right? Because Chinese government always wants to blame everything for that, you know, America's did that, right? America's did that. And the Chinese diplomat, like Zhao Lijian, he was the first time, he sent out the message on his Twitter claiming that Wuhan coronavirus came from U.S. But it's like a, you know, it's a joke. I think it's a joke, because it was indeed brought by the U.S. How come, only outbreak in Wuhan, right? It's just impossible. But I think that's the Chinese government's propaganda. You know, they would definitely do that to shift the blame, because the Chinese government is very good at turn every disaster into their favor. You know, they can always censor the statistics, say, okay, now China has no more coronavirus, although they just do not report any confirmed case, and in many places they stopped testing the coronavirus. And then they can say, oh, China is doing such a great job. Chinese people have to thank the Communist Party for saving them, and the world have to thank China for saving the world. And, of course, they do not want to take the responsibility of, the outbreak of coronavirus. You probably have read the news how the Chinese government silenced the doctors from
mm-hmm.
speaking out
mm-hmm.
and creating the make the outbreak. You know, they didn't contain the virus at the first time, and then caused such a disaster later on. And now they want to shift the blame. They want to blame the U.S. for doing that. And I just feel if any Westerners believe in this kind of blame, I would say they must have been very, very brainwashed by the Communist Party.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're saying if Americans believe it, they're brainwashed by the Communist Party in China. Or maybe they're just brainwashed. Maybe they just hate America. You know, they think America's always up to some kind of shenanigans or something, and they're not being straightforward and honest with the American people. So the numbers coming out of China, can we trust them? The numbers?
No, definitely not. Mm. They have been lying since the very beginning. So the storylines are the Chinese doctors already knew in December that this virus is highly contagious. And on December 31st, about eight doctors. They had they were talking about this in a doctor in three different doctor chatting groups. Basically, doctors were just reminding each other, and the nurses say, "Oh, we should be take precautions because the SARS like." You know, new coronavirus is spreading. We should wear protective suits and facial masks. And then the government, the Wuhan government, actually, took them and gave them a warning, said they were spreading the rumors, asked them to sign statements, acknowledge that they spread lies. And the Chinese state media took all their statements, assured the Chinese people that, you know, it was a rumor to have the that the coronavirus was spreading, and that was December 31st. And for 3 weeks, the Chinese government insisted that the virus was not contagious, like it just came from animals, like there was no human to human transmission. They were not able to suppress it, to fully censor the news, because on January 13th, in Thailand. Thailand government found that there was one woman from Wuhan carrying this new coronavirus. And that was when all over the world found out, okay, China is having this contagious coronavirus. And then that was already January 20th or so, China admitted that this coronavirus was human-to-human transmission. And then they have been censoring the number of statistics. If you just add up the number reported by each individual neighborhood, you can find many numbers, statistics from the neighborhoods, the streets, from small areas. If you add them up, you'll find they're much bigger than the number disclosed by the Chinese government. Even nowadays, when China claims that they had no more new cases of coronavirus, I have been reading the Chinese Epoch Times, one of the largest global outlet for uncensored news about China. Just yesterday, I read, 2 days ago, I read a piece of evidence from the Wuhan Health Commission. It's an internal document that said on March 14th, Wuhan had 91 confirmed cases. But the Wuhan government announced on March 14th, they only had 4 confirmed cases. So they have been lying all the time from the very beginning until now, because Chinese government want to create this false image. They want to create this delusion to Chinese people and to the world that they contain the virus, they fix everything, so the world should thank China and adopt the China style.
Well, we have one more minute. And we're going to, when we come back from the break, we're going to continue this because I want to get more information. And I know my listeners want to get more information. One of the things that I want to mention is that you told me that when a virus is man-made, it's stronger and it can skip from one species to the next. Let's touch on that when we come back from the break. Okay, Wen?
Yes.
Okay, we'll be right back. I'm speaking with Dr. Wen Chen, who is a biologist and curator of genomics at Caltech. That's impressive. I'm impressed. She's smart, folks. So come back, and we're going to continue talking about life in the time of coronavirus right here on the Naked Truth Report. All I need is the air that I breathe and to love. Welcome back, Truth Warriors and Mythbusters. So let's just summarize what we were going over with my guest, Dr. Wen Chen, who is a biologist, and she curates genes, genomics, genes, gene sequence. So the gene sequence from Wuhan province indicates, or the gene sequence, rather, of coronavirus indicates that it's man-made. It's 99% like another virus that was made by, what was the doctor's name?
Shi Zhen Li. The Wuhan coronavirus is 96% identical to a natural virus from Yunnan. And that natural virus is in stock in a lab in Wuhan.
Oh, so the issue is, why do they make viruses? What is the motivation or intent to do that?
That's a good question, actually. It's very, very controversial, right? I think the purpose of scientific research is to make the world better. But unfortunately, that's not the case to the Chinese government. Of course, like, you know, maybe they're curious, and or maybe they're just making biological weapons. That's all possible. But actually, in 2015, the Nature article published by Shi Zhenli, the lab in Wuhan Institute of Virology, mm-hmm. and she actually collaborated with University of North Carolina. So U.S. government also partially funded her research of making more contagious virus. And of course, like a scientist, some scientists protested, say like you shouldn't do that because it's too dangerous to the world. And then U.S. stopped funding this kind of research. Mm-hmm. But China, it seems like, continue to fund this kind of research. And it's not the first time that China do something so dangerous. Like, actually, 2 years ago, some Chinese scientists, they did a genetically edited baby. You may have heard of the news about a CRISPR baby. So they genetically modified the embryos of two baby girls and making them, you know, born with some kind of, like, they say, make them resist AIDS. But, like, you know, this is very, very dangerous. And, of course, like, it was shocked the whole world. And it's not surprising that China is doing something like that, making more contagious virus. You can say, hey, see, we are very advanced in research. We can get top publications, and we are, you know, they just say, like, okay, we can't. Basically, this mentality of like a mafia. See, we can't cure cancer. We can make something more deadly than cancer.
Mm. And, you know, of course, they can't admit that the coronavirus was man-made in a lab in Wuhan, because then they would be liable for recklessly allowing this to infect the world.
It's very hard for us to find evidence. You know, for things like that, it's very, very difficult for the outside to chase down, to confirm that, because the lab will never admit that, the government will never admit that. They will never allow you to do independent investigation.
But if you know that the gene sequence is 96% similar to a virus that was man-made in Hunan province, is that what you said? Isn't that evidence?
It's 96% to a natural virus. But like, you know, it's very difficult to find out whether it's man-made or not man-made. I just give you one example, okay? Mm-hmm. My in-laws, we live in Pasadena, right? In my garden, like, we planted cucumber and the Chinese bitter melon together. And then, like, you know, we produced some, like, a bitter cucumber, all right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a new species. But, you know, we deliberately put them together to produce a new species. But it looks very natural. And we can claim that it just naturally happened. We didn't purposely make it. We just selected it. And there's no way for the outside world to tell whether it's really naturally happened or we made it happen. It's the same thing to this Wuhan coronavirus. Like, we know the lab is doing this kind of research. They are making something very deadly. But we cannot confirm that they indeed make this particular virus, because they will never admit that unless you can find insiders from their lab to leak the information, you know, unless you can break into their computer system. Unfortunately, you know, I sometimes really wish we have hackers like that, right, to do something very useful.
So what, give us some good news. What can we foresee or anticipate the lifespan of this virus being in United States? When will it plateau? Can you tell us that information? Level out?
I cannot really tell, actually. You know, sometimes we really have to say it all depends on whether Mother Nature will forgive us. You know, SARS only lasted for like a few months. And the Spanish flu also was seasonal, and, you know, it had 3 outbreaks and killed many people. But, I mean, from this whole incident, what I found was that those countries or those regions have close tie with the Chinese government are more affected. Mm. And those who resist the Chinese government, like Taiwan and Hong Kong, mm-hmm. are doing much better. For example, Taiwan, right? Taiwan is really close to China, and everyone predicted at the beginning that Taiwan would be the worst region. It's going to be the second largest region be affected. But the Taiwan government, like, you know, the current Taiwan government, they were very alerted from the very beginning because they were very, very anti-Communist Party. And so, like, early in December, right after the coronavirus news came out, like, right after they heard that China had this new coronavirus, they started to check every passenger from China on the airplane to find out whether they had a fever and, you know, quarantine them. So Taiwan is doing very, very well now. Like, they never trusted the Chinese government's statistics. They did their own research, especially the World Health Organization also ignored Taiwan because the World Health Organization was, like, already totally, like, infiltrated by the Chinese government. So Taiwan purely relied on their own efforts to contain this virus, and they have been doing a great job. So I think the key for us in the U.S. is, like, we should not trust the data from the Chinese government either. Like, we should not open the borderline with China, and because China still has the coronavirus. If we let them in, you know, there will be a second outbreak, mm-hmm. even if we can control it here.
Mm-hmm. So you agree with Trump in banning travel? Obviously, naturally, that's the right way to go. But
definitely, yeah.
Yeah. How do you think we have the proper protocols to suppress the activation or the escalation, rather, of the virus? Do you think this self-isolation and social distancing is the proper way to preclude the escalation of the virus? And do you anticipate it escalating? Are more people, in other words, what is the denominator? Do you think more people are infected by this coronavirus?
I think we're taking the right approach. Definitely, it definitely helps social distance, definitely helps closing the border, definitely helps to slow down the spread. And we also hope that, you know, this virus is seasonal like other coronavirus, because most of the coronavirus we know are seasonal. Of course, we hope that, you know, we're doing the right thing, although sometimes I question, like, you know, maybe people shouldn't be in such a huge panic. I think that's the only concern, you know, the impact to our economy. I just feel like, you know, we should take some good procedure, but people should not panic. You know, life should continue. Like, it will slow down, but we should not panic. I think that's the key. Sometimes I just feel like the media created this, like, you know, very panicking, like, atmosphere, like, make everyone feel nervous.
Mm-hmm. So Newsom's number,
Newsom said
that more than 56% of Californians will be infected. Do you think that's an exaggeration?
Being infected does not mean that you will have symptoms, mm-hmm. you know. So you may never know, because maybe most of the people being infected have no symptoms. Then it doesn't really matter, right? You know, the only problem is, like, you will spread to someone who can be, you know, that can be deadly to particular people. Mm. But being affected doesn't mean, like, they will die. Like, you know, because most of the people got infected, like, may not have symptoms, because usually people do not test those who have no symptoms.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, you say China is about censoring information. And that you were brainwashed by the Chinese government. Touch on that.
Yeah, I came to the United States for graduate school. So I finished undergraduate in China. And I came to the United States and very surprised to find that I was found out that I was so brainwashed. Like, I remember the incident in 1995 when I started to work as a student in a lab at Caltech, and my American lab mates asked me the Tiananmen massacre. You know, you all know the story of Tankman, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was so brainwashed. I just totally bluntly like replied that there was no massacre. I said nobody was killed in 1989. And because when the Tiananmen massacre happened, I was still in high school. And on all Chinese state-run media, we were shown dead bodies of soldiers. We told that students killed the soldiers. And we were told that the government of China never killed any student. And when my American friends showed me the video and the photos of the Tiananmen massacre, I said Hollywood made them. Because that was what the government of China told me. They told this to everyone in China that, oh, Hollywood was like trying to demonize China, and they made all these pictures.
Mm-hmm.
It took me like 5 or 6 years to awake from this kind of brainwash. Mm-hmm. I remember it was like in 2001 or so, I realized like I got to do something for the rest of my life to speak out on this. Because many Westerners, they're clueless about the true life in China. And unfortunately, majority of the mainstream media in the U.S., they do not cover the true life in China. They only took the standard report from the Chinese state-run media and repeat whatever the Chinese government want them to say.
Well, tell us what the true life...
from individuals like me.
Yeah, well, tell us what the true life is like in China.
The true life is in China. My family in China now are still in quarantine, my relatives.
Oh, yeah?
But I can tell you a little bit about my parents in China. And they still like that, I think. They survived the Great Cultural Revolution in China. That was for 10 years. The Chinese government saw like any education can give one independent thinking. And then they shut down the whole education system in China for 10 years. And my parents both graduated from top universities in China. And right after they graduated, the Cultural Revolution started. And they got, basically as a punishment, they were taken to countryside. My dad thought that he could become a nuclear scientist, but he was taken to a coal mine in Sichuan and digged coal for 10 years. And my mom, they were already married at that time, was taken to another province. So they were forced to live separately for 10 years. They can only see each other for a couple of weeks every year. And my mom raised me and my brother by herself. And my mom thought she could enter the central government, become official, because she graduated from a top university majoring in political science. And she was taken to a car shop and became a secretary for the rest of her life. And the reason the Communist Party allowed them to get back together was because my dad's health deteriorated in that coal mine because of the malnutrition. He had a stomach disease, and three-quarters of his stomach was removed. He lost so much blood that the hospital thought he was going to die. And at that time, the government of China said, okay, let your wife take care of you. So he was sent to my mom's place. And fortunately, my mom took care of him, and he recovered. And they ended up living together. But unfortunately, my dad was never able to be a nuclear scientist. He ended up working as an engineer in a car shop until he retired. And maybe that was the reason that I wanted to be a scientist. Since a young age, when I was a six-year-old girl, I told everyone that I wanted to be a scientist. And, you know, eventually I lived my dad's dream. And I told you about the Tiananmen massacre, right? And
mm-hmm.
I came to the U.S. In 1994, and I remember it was around 98 or 99. At that time, the Chinese government still encouraged people to practice Tai Chi and the traditional Chinese culture. And we all learned this practice called Falun Gong. It's a meditation practice, very good for health, and it's based on traditional Chinese culture. With the principle truthfulness, compassion, tolerance. And most of the Chinese students at Caltech learned this meditation. It was very good for health, and some of us, like me, stick to it. But just 1 year later, in July 1999, the Chinese government found there were about 10% of population in China do this Falun Gong meditation, and they realized that this is independent from the communism. Because it's meditation, there was no church or temple, no leader, and they can't just control this population and brainwash them, because they have their own principle: truthfulness, compassion, tolerance. So in July 1999, the Chinese government started a massive persecution towards Falun Gong. Millions of people were detained just for doing meditation like this, and I cannot go back to China anymore because I still do Falun Gong practice, so that's why I chose to stay in the U.S. To continue my study, continue my family and meditation in the U.S. But unfortunately, people like me in China, many of them ended up going to jail, and they're even worse than that, they became victims of Chinese state's sanctioned forced organ harvesting. You may have heard something about forced organ harvesting towards Falun Gong, because here in the U.S., people usually wait for years for organ transplant. But in China, every hospital would claim that they can find donors, quoted donors, within 24 hours, because the Chinese government has a long history of taking organs from death row prisoners. They execute people when the buyers show up. They just took the organs for you. They killed the person, the victim. And after they started the persecution towards Falun Gong, the government of China realized that, this meditation group, they don't smoke, they don't drink, they are very healthy. They have very good organs. So many people from Korea, from Taiwan, from U.S., including UCLA Hospital, they go to China for transplants. And very likely they got organs from Falun Gong, from Christians, from Uyghurs, from innocent people who were thrown to labor camps or jail just because of their religion, for their freedom of speech, for their sticking to traditional Chinese culture. They refused to be brainwashed. And that is a real life in China that very few Western media cover. And that's why I continue to speak in many community organizations about this subject. And even in Wuhan nowadays, many people in Wuhan, at the very beginning, they may say, we don't care about human rights. But the way Chinese government censor people, the way if the Chinese government can take organs from innocent Falun Gong practitioners, the government will not care how many people in Wuhan will die from the coronavirus. And that's why the government would silence the doctors. They would suppress the media from reporting the coronavirus just for the economy. And that's why the coronavirus killed so many people in China and so many people in Italy, in France, in the U.S., in Spain. So that is the true life of China. And don't say that it does not affect here in the U.S., because we all take the consequence of the censorship of the human rights abuses in China. Mm-hmm. And eventually all of us became victims of that.
Yeah, and just in terms of our we have just two more minutes, and I just want to say, just in terms of our foreign policy, knowing that most of our pharmaceuticals are made in China, that's not a good thing. For Americans to be so reliant on China for pharmaceuticals and other things.
Yeah, I mean, what really is alerting is that nowadays, many countries, Western companies, especially U.S., we're very short of face masks. And the U.S. companies, face masks are 3M and Honeywear. They manufacture their face masks in China. But now Chinese government do not allow them to ship the face mask back to the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, they chokehold all the medical supplies. Once we have this business tie with China, at this very critical moment, the Chinese government uses this business tie to threaten the lives of Americans.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Excuse me, I'm coughing. Dr. Wen Chen, thank you for being a guest on the Naked Truth Report. I'm going to have you on again to talk about communism, to get into some more specifics about communism, because many folks, particularly Sanders supporters, think communism is, you know, socialism is like one step to communism, and they think socialism is a good thing and communism is a good thing. So, Dr. Wen Chen, I want to have you back. Thank you for being a guest on the Naked Truth Report.
Definitely. Very glad to be here. I would definitely be happy to come back.
Okay, thank you. That was Dr. Wen Chen, who is a biologist, and she studies genetic material, the sequence of genes. This is a good thing. And she was talking to us about the coronavirus and the communist regime in China. Dr. Wen Chen. She teaches at Caltech. So I'll be right back next week with more on probably what? Probably coronavirus. Anyway, we'll be back next week. Thank you for joining me. The Naked Truth Report. I'm Kathleen Wells. Thanks. Bye.